seated for just a moment. Welcome to Salem Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here to worship the one true and living God with us this morning, who is our hope. And I'm so thankful for a God that when, as we learned in Sunday school, we come to Him and say, if you can help me, He doesn't turn us away. And we can go to Him and say, God, I believe. Will you help my unbelief? And so wherever you are this morning, that's the God that is here and loves you and is here to meet you right where you are. And He is our only hope. So thankful for that this morning. Pastor, will you come and lead us in prayer?
Thank you, Brother Todd. Don't you just love Brother Todd and his heart? Absolutely. Uh-oh. I'm all hung up here, Suze. Here we go. Okay. I asked Brother Todd if he wouldn't mind, I'd like to have us a word of prayer. Something ain't right. I think we're good now. All right. We are. Thank you. I asked Brother Todd if we could have special prayer this morning. We've got a couple of folks in the hospital I want to have special prayer for. And then we got somebody here I want to have special prayer for. Matthew Falk is a young man in our church congregation. Many of you know Matthew. He's been sick for a long time. He's been dealing with kidney failure. And he's in Jackson General, and they've got a lot of fluid off of him. He's actually feeling a little better. But there's probably dialysis in his future. And so we want to pray for him. I'm grateful that he's feeling better. But he is a sick young man. And so we want to lift him up in prayer. Also, I wanted to mention to you Rebecca Autry. She used to be Rebecca Damron. She is just over six months pregnant and been having some complications with her pregnancy. She's in the hospital. The baby keeps trying to come. And so they're trying to hold off the delivery, and she had more pains today, and so they're dealing with that. So we need to pray that the Lord will hold that off so the baby can get stronger and better. I know Rebecca and her family's close friends with Jeff and Courtney Anderson, and Jeff and Courtney is over there to be with them this morning and have prayer with them, so I want to lift them up as well. But I want to have special prayer for my friend Rosie Dunnigan. Rosie's back in the house today, been sick for a long time. And so I want to anoint Rosie and pray over her. I'm going to ask if her and Barry would come and just sit on the front row right here. And I'm going to ask Randy and Kim, if you would, come sit with them. And we want to anoint you with oil. Miss Rosie, sure is good to see you, girl. Rosie's son, he's a youth pastor at First Baptist Trenton here in town. And so appreciate them. And I just want to anoint you with oil. A little bit on you right here. As you know, oil is nothing supernatural, but the Bible speaks of it as a symbol of the Holy Spirit of God. And the book of James tells us that if we're sick, call the elders of the church, lay hands on them, anoint them with oil. And that's exactly what we want to do. Rosie's had a shunt put in her brain to relieve some pressure and help her stability a little bit. Been dealing with that for a long time. And I asked Rosie, did they put a shunt in Barry's brain? She said he didn't have a brain. So he ain't got to worry about that. But Rosie does, and we want to pray for you. So whoever would, I'm going to ask you would come forward. Just stand with me, church. Let's stand together. And whoever would like to come forward, just surround them the best you can. And we want to lay hands on you and tell you we love you. You know Jesus lives in your heart, right, Rosie? No doubt. No doubt in your mind. None in mine either. We're going to pray He takes care of you. I appreciate you and Barry. Your family and y'all being here with us. We love you. All right. We pray for you. God, thank you for this sweet family. Thank you for what you've been doing in Rosie's life, Lord. And she's much better. She's in your house today. There was a long period of time she couldn't even get up and go at all. Today she's in your house worshiping. And so we celebrate that. And we celebrate you making that possible. We continue to pray for her. Pray over her. Pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit in her life. Supernatural power. You're the Prince of Peace. You're the great physician. We thank you for doctors and There's a lot of smart people out there that can do some amazing things. But God, you're the one. You're the one that brings healing. So thank you for her. Thank you for Barry. Thank you for their boys, their family. God, I pray you continue to be with her, watch over her, get her well, and back part of our everyday life, we ask. Thank you for what you've done, what you're going to do. Lift this up in your name, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen indeed. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're the most handsome or beautiful person I've ever seen.
Morning, everyone. I would like to ask Brother Joel and Brother Todd to come forward, please. October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and I think we have two of the best. Amen to that. We see them on Sunday here. There's so much they do past this day that we don't even know. But just the appreciation is hard to explain to the both of you. So here's a small token of our appreciation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
y'all so
give
much.
Us a love. Oh, rascal. Thank you, church. I love you.
Brother Joel. Mr. Jimmy Barnes has made a paddle.
Oh, cool, man. Something. A paddle?
Bend over.
Oh. Oh, man. Awesome, Jimmy.
Thank you,
man. God bless you. Let's see what you got here. Look at that. Awesome. You see that, church? Thank you. Appreciate you. See that. I get to keep this, and I got to hand this to Suzanne. All right. Church, thank you. Y'all not ever gonna get rid of us. You keep showering us with love like that. Thank you. We love you. We love you. I love my Lord, and I love my job. And so thank you. I love you. I love you. I want you to know that. I love you. And I appreciate Todd and his heart. Appreciate them so much. I want us to begin with a special time of prayer this morning. Also, we've got Israel on our hearts and minds and a lot going on in the world. So I'm going to ask if you would stand with me one more time, all right? You're getting the exercise today. And we want to pray for Israel, thank the Lord for bringing home our family from there, and just talk to God a moment, okay? Let's pray. God, thank you for all the showers of blessings you put on us. Lord, we're living during difficult days, and there's a lot of turmoil and chaos in this world. But we know you're the God of peace. You're the Prince of Peace. And we pray for your peace over the nation of Israel. We pray for their protection. We pray that the terrorists would put down their weapons and that you would have peace in that land. And I pray that they would turn to you, God. I thank you, Lord, that you brought home our friends and family that were there. You got them out. You got them home. They're safe. God, we thank you for that. I pray for those that are still there. I pray for our military folks that's on the wall guarding and doing humanitarian efforts, Lord, that you keep them safe. Thank you for the story of Israel. Thank you for the Savior that came through Israel. And God, we pray peace in that land. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen indeed. You may be seated. Take your Bibles and open with me to the book of Philippians. Turn to Philippians chapter 4. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, Gibson Electric Power Company. So Philippians chapter 4. You may not remember a lot of stuff I say, but you'll never forget that, will you? Philippians chapter 4. Church, we live in very unsettling days. Unsettling may even be an understatement. These are very intense days. Quite frankly, very scary days. The war in Israel kind of has us all on edge, doesn't it? Our hearts are broken at the barbaric images we see against innocent women and children that's been unleashed against Israel. The torture, the slaughter. We're heartbroken by what we see unfolding. We even had friends and family there when the outbreak took place. We thank God that He brought them home safe and sound. We still pray for those that are there. We still pray for the military who are there. We pray for peace in Israel. I pray the terrorists will lay down their weapons and lay down their hatred and pick up the gospel of Jesus Christ. I pray the Jews will lay down their doubt and their disbelief and pick up the gospel of Jesus Christ. I pray the mobs in the streets of America who are protesting Israel and praising Hamas, most of which are college kids who have no idea what they're even doing, I pray they will lay down their protest and pick up the gospel of Jesus Christ. But it just seems that every day the whole world is spiraling into a deeper, demented, immoral, ungodly decay. Even before the Israel attack, we all were kind of uneasy already. There's so much crime in the street, so much hatred for one another, so much dispute and division. The streets are unsafe. Our Christian values are hated. We're even seen as the enemy. But not only are these chaotic days, these are also costly days. The cost of living is climbing every day. Can I get a witness? Gas prices, food prices, clothing, housing, everything we use and need, it's all going up. Everything is getting more expensive. Immorality is going up, and the cost of living is going up. It's all going up. But yet, less and less people are going to church. There's more people living in America today than ever before, and yet less people going to church today. Baptisms are down across our nation. Baptisms are down across our state. Less people are in church. Giving is down. Ministry is down. Passion for Jesus Christ, loyalty to His written word, faithfulness to His house, it's all down. Everything else is going up, but anything pertaining to Christ and Christianity is going down. These are difficult days. So today, with all that on our mind, we want to answer a very important question today. When should a Christian worry? When should a Christian worry with what's happening around us? Should we be worried? With the war in Israel, should we be worried? Is all of this the beginning of the end? Is Jesus getting ready to come back? Is He about to show up? I believe He is. And if He is, we ought not be worried. We ought to be watching. Amen. Look up, because our redemption is at hand. But in the meantime, while we await the arrival of our Lord, what about the decay of our nation? What about the decline of our way of life? Should we be worried? Should a Christian worry? And if so, then when? I mean, these days that I see certainly would be a good time to be worried if we're going to be worried. Have you seen the news lately? Are you worried? Do you feel uneasy about what you see? When should a Christian worry? Well, let's find out what God says. Philippians chapter 4, let's look at verse 6 and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, and with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, that will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Church, when should a Christian worry? Well, according to God, right here, a Christian should worry never. He should worry never. It says right here, black ink on white paper, it says, be anxious for nothing. Let the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, in other words, the natural understanding of this world, let His supernatural peace guard your hearts, guard your minds, Jesus. Church, God says, do not worry. Therefore, do not worry. Now, that's a pretty easy concept, seeing we're sitting here as snug as a bug in a rug, right? We're sitting here in a comfortable chair in a comfortable building. Seems pretty easy for us to say that, knowing we're all going to go eat lunch after this is done. So from our current perspective, it's easy not to worry. But that's not the case for so many in the world today. What about those who live in constant danger? What about those who have lost loved ones due to violence? What about those who have no money? God says, do not worry. How can that be? God says to them as well, be anxious in nothing. Be anxious in nothing? Really? I mean, have you seen the news? Be anxious in nothing? Come on, man. Well, God has much to say about stress and worry. Let's listen to this. Let's remind ourselves of a few verses in Scripture about stress and worry. These will be on the screen. 2 Timothy, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of sound mind. Isaiah, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you in my righteous right hand. Joshua said this, be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Proverbs 3, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. Hebrews 13, for He Himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. How can we face this world today and not have a state of worry? We must understand that God is with us. God cares for us, and God will always protect His children. Yes, there's chaos in the streets, but there's no chaos in heaven. There's immorality, there's sin, there's hatred here, but there's purity and peace in heaven. There are problems here, but there's only plans in heaven. God is on His throne. God is in control. God is not worried by what He sees happening here. He told us all this would happen. Thousands of years ago, Jesus told us about these days. God's not worried. God's in control. You don't have to worry. God is in control. Now, does that mean we won't ever get sick? No, it doesn't mean that. Does that mean we won't ever have something bad, sometimes really bad, happen to us? No, doesn't mean that. Does that mean we won't ever die? No, doesn't even mean that. What God's promises do mean is this. We don't have to worry about sickness, even though we get sick, because God's always with us. And He's bigger, He's more powerful than any sickness. He walks with us through our sickness. We don't have to worry about bad things that happen to us when they happen to us, because God's always bigger than bad things. He is powerful. He always walks with us through our bad times. We don't even have to worry about death, because Jesus Christ has overcome death in the grave when He walked out of His tomb alive and well. And because of Jesus Christ, we can say, oh death, where is your sting? Oh grave, where is your victory? Hallelujah. Jesus has overcome even death. So even death does not have to worry those who God holds in His hand. Can you say amen to that? Therefore, it doesn't really matter what's happening around us in this world. It doesn't matter what's happening even in our own life. Fear not, do not worry, because God is on His throne and He is in full control. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, I'll say this. There's a however. It would be impossible for us not to worry a little bit. It would be impossible for us not to be concerned about some things. If you've ever had kids that grow up and get their driver's license and move out, it would be impossible not to worry a little bit. Amen? But what God is trying to tell us here in this passage is this. The things we most often worry about, we ought not be worrying about. Let's look at this passage more closely. Chapter 4, I've got verse 1 on the screen. Let's start in verse 2. I implore Euodia and I implore Syntyche to be in the same mind in the Lord. And I urge you also, true companion, help these women who labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and the rest of my fellow workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication and with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Paul was speaking here about two women, Euodia and Syntyche. Evidently, these two women had gotten sideways with one another. And evidently, they got sideways because they were worrying about something they ought not be worrying about. I mean, isn't that the source so often of much disharmony and discord in our life? We get to worrying about something we ought not be worrying about. And so Paul addresses this, and that's why he writes here, I implore Euodia, I implore Syntyche, rejoice in the Lord. Again, I say rejoice, let your gentleness be made known to all. Be anxious in nothing, and the peace of God will guard you. Church, there are so many things that worry us that ought not be worrying us. And in reality, the problem with many Christians today is that they're living their life completely backwards. They're worrying about what they ought not be worrying about, and they're not worrying about what they should be worrying about. Many Christians, I believe many of you here today, that would be true. You're worrying about stuff you ought not be worrying about, and you're not worrying about what you should be worrying about. So for the remainder of our time this morning, let's consider what Christians ought not be worrying about, and let's consider what Christians should be worrying about. When should a Christian worry? Well, first, most people, even most Christians worry, they worry about their health, and they worry about getting sick. Well, what did God say? I'm just going to read this. It won't be on the screen. I'll read it to you. Let me remind you something about health and sickness. These words are found in Psalm 139. It says, for you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you, and when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth, your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed. And in your book, they all were written, the days fashioned for me. So church, even before God made you in your mother's womb, God knew the number of your days. So it's not sickness that numbers your days, it's God that numbers your days. And if God formed you, can He not heal you? And if He doesn't heal you, can He not take you home? So do not worry about your health or sickness. But not just health and sickness. Many Christians worry about their money. Not just their health, but their wealth. But what did God say? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said these words, Matthew 6. He says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. And then he said these words about wealth in Malachi chapter 3. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing, there will not be room enough to receive it. So do not worry about your money. You be kingdom-minded and you tithe. And God will make sure you have plenty of money. The Lord is our financial advisor, not Wall Street. Many Christians worry about their day-to-day life. But what did God say? Jesus also said this in Matthew 6. He says, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap, nor do they gather into barns, but yet your heavenly Father feeds every one of them. Are you not of much more value than they? Which of you, by worrying, can add 1 inch to your height? So why do you worry about your clothing? Consider the lilies of the field. They neither sow nor spin. Yet I say to you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed as eloquently as the lilies of the field. So if God so chooses to clothe the grass of the field, which today is here and tomorrow mowed down and thrown in the fire, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry by saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? But yet most people, most Christians, worry about their day-to-day life, even though it clearly says here, God will supply all your needs. And finally, many Christians worry about tomorrow. Many people, many Christians worry about things that hadn't even happened yet. They worry about stuff that hadn't even happened. But what did God say? Matthew 6, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own. Sufficient for today is its own trouble. Now, I can say amen to that. So why worry about things that haven't even happened yet? We got enough to keep us busy today, much less worrying about something that hadn't even happened. Many Christians are living life backwards. They're worrying about what they ought not be worrying about. They're worrying about their health. They're worrying about their money. They're worrying about their everyday life. They're even worrying about future things that hasn't even happened yet. But God says, be anxious for nothing. Let the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, the understanding of this natural world, let his supernatural peace guard your hearts, guard your minds in Christ Jesus. Church, God says, do not worry. Do not worry because God's on his throne and he's in control. Do not worry. However, there are some things that Christians should worry about. If we're not to worry about those things, if God's going to take care of those things in our life, which he told us so clearly he would, then what should a Christian worry about? A Christian should worry about, number one, unconfessed sin. A Christian should worry about unconfessed sin in their life. Do you know why? Because God will not hear your prayers of unconfessed sin in your life. Did you know that? Listen to this verse. It'll be on the screen, Isaiah 59. But your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden your face, his face from you so that he will not hear. A Christian with unconfessed sin should be worried. They should be worried because God will not even hear their prayers. They're a sitting duck for catastrophe and deep sorrow. Many folks are worrying about things they ought not be worrying about, things like health and wealth, things like life and death. But instead, as a Christian, you should be worrying about cleanliness in your heart, unconfessed sins, because your sin separates you from a holy God. Are you protecting something in your life, some pet sin, some private sin that you're guarding, that you're ignoring, that you're pretending that's not there, you're struggling with it? If you don't confess it, it'll destroy you. A Christian should worry about unconfessed sin. A Christian should worry about, number two, blatant rebellion. Blatant rebellion. Blatant rebellion is far worse than unconfessed sin. Unconfessed sin is denying you've done anything wrong. Blatant rebellion is saying, I don't care. I don't care. Blatant rebellion is saying, so what? A couple, an unmarried couple living together is blatant rebellion. Having sex before marriage is blatant rebellion. Homosexuality and transgenderism is blatant rebellion. Abortion, blatant rebellion. Being affiliated with or embracing any ungodly or immoral behavior is blatant rebellion. A Christian who does not tithe is blatant rebellion. Putting something ahead of being in God's house on God's day is blatant rebellion. God said, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. It's a command. To put other activities ahead of God on His day is blatant rebellion. Mark, you might have should have waited to the end of the service. And concerning blatant rebellion, God gives very strict warning. I want to show you this one. Turn with me. Turn to the left to Romans. Romans chapter 1. Blatant rebellion, God does not play around with. All right? Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. I want you to see these verses. Blatant rebellion. That's what a Christian ought to be worried about. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifest to them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify Him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Chapter 2, verse 4. Or do you despise the riches of His goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? But in accordance with your hardness and your impotent heart, you are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to each one according to his deeds. Eternal life to those who by patient continuance in doing good seek for glory, honor, and immortality. But to those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath will come. Tribulation and anguish on every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace in everyone who works what is good, to the Jew first and also the Greek. For there is no partiality with God. God's warning is clear. Woe to those who would call evil good and good evil. A Christian who is living in blatant rebellion should be worried. A Christian should worry about number three, prayerless decisions. A Christian who makes hasty and prayerless decisions, especially important decisions, will end up in a pickle every time. God says you have not because you ask not. As a Christian, we should pray about every important decision that we make. But if you've made some bad choices, if you made some snap judgments, if you made some hasty decisions and you did not pray about it, you're going to end up in a pickle. So start praying now. Ask for God's help now before it's too late. A Christian who lives a prayerless life will live a powerless life. If you're in the habit of doing and not asking for direction, then yeah, you ought to be worried. You're headed straight for trouble. And a Christian should worry about number four, apathy for lostness. Church, as a Christian, we have but one purpose on this earth, to bring glory to God by telling everyone about the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's our purpose. Without that purpose, God would just take us to heaven. But He leaves us on this earth to bring glory to Him by telling everyone about the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the first and foremost purpose on this earth. Don't forget what we talked about last week. You remember what we talked about? How God placed us as His watchmen. We're His ambassador. We are His watchmen. And if we do not warn the people of the incoming doom, warning them of lostness and eternity in hell, then their blood will be on our hands. You remember that? Church, that's a very strong and graphic image, isn't it? Their blood will be on our hands. That's what God said in Ezekiel chapter 3. When should a Christian worry? A Christian should worry when they have apathy for lostness. Very worried. Our heart should break for all lostness. Every day, I looked it up, I Googled it. 150,000 people die every day worldwide, and most of them go to hell. Every day, nearly 150,000 people. Most likely, most of the deaths that took place in Israel, now taking place in Palestine, most likely, most of those deaths, they're going to hell. It should break our heart. As a Christian, the overwhelming heaviness of lostness should be on our hearts. If you are a Christian and you have apathy towards lostness in this world, you had better be worried. Because one day we're going to give an account to the righteous judge. What did we do with the talents he gave us? Did we bury them in the sand? Or did we tell people that Jesus saves? Jesus saves. Church, we live in very unsettling days. Unsettling is an understatement. These are intense days. These are scary days. But yet God says, don't be worried. Don't be worried about what you see in the world. There's chaos in the street, but there's peace in heaven. There's problems here, but there's only plans in heaven. God is on his throne. He told us how these days would be. He said he would care for us. He holds us in his hand. No one can pluck us out of his hand. He's going to take care of his children. Don't worry. But instead of worrying about what's out there, we should be worrying about what's in here. A Christian should be worried about unconfessed sin. A Christian should be worried about blatant rebellion. A Christian should be worried about prayerless decisions. A Christian should be worried about apathy for lostness. When you worry about the right things, you won't worry about the wrong things. So let me ask you, what are you worried about? What's worrying you? We need to spend our concern on cleansing the house, because one day the King is coming to get us. We're not of this world, we're in the world. We're to be a light in a dark place. We should rejoice that God chose us to be his brightest light during the darkest times. Oh, how I wish people would lay down their weapons and accept Jesus, and we need to pray for them. But we need to make sure our house is in order. And the things that should worry us should be that intimate part of our heart as we prepare to meet the King. What are you worried about? Have you met the Prince of Peace? His name is Jesus, and he'll change your life. He'll write your name down in his book, and can't nobody take it out of God's book. If you'll give him your heart, you believe him, you repent of your sins, say, Lord, I want you to be my Savior. Understand there's no other way. You came in the world. You lived a perfect life. You died as an innocent man on the cross. God laid on him the iniquities of us all. He died. 3 days later, he arose from the dead, victorious over our sin, victorious over death. And the Bible says, if you will confess that and believe that and be baptized and make a commitment to that, he will care for you. If you haven't done that, I invite you to do it right now. Stand with me, church. We're going to have an invitation, and that is going